atau kerayaan yang diberikan kepada pendatang asing yang tidak mengikut perlembagaan persekutuan. Walau bagaimanapun, terdapat keterangan yang mencukupi untuk menunjukkan bahwa pendatang yang bukan rakyat Malaysia diberi kad pengenalan biru secara haram oleh sindiket atau individu tertentu dan selepas itu mendaftar diri mereka sebagai pengundi dalam daftar pemilih berdasarkan kad pengenalan mereka.
Pengeluaran secara haram dan mungkin ada sindiket yang terlibat yang dimaklumkan mungkin ada berkaitan dengan pegawai kerajaan. Okay. Jadi tak ada isu politik yang dibangkitkan oleh Suraja.
I have spent a large part of my life living in Sabah, which is my homeland. And of course, I have special feelings for this land of mine. And I have seen it progress or degress, as some people say. So what is actually happening now is a result of what was done decades ago.
Now, during the late 60s and early 70s, many Filipinos from the southern Philippines, not so many from Indonesia, but they were also from Indonesia, but the one that landed in Sabah were mostly Philippines, Filipinos from the south of the country, fled to Sabah due to the conflict that was occurring, the conflict between the Philippine government and the separatist Muslim South.
Dan juga sampai 100,000, 50,000-60,000 orang datang ke Sabah.
Many of them were Suluks. They were welcome and encouraged by the late Tun Mustafa, the former governor and later chief minister of Sabah, despite the fact that they did not have valid documents.
Bila mereka datang ke Sabah ini diterima oleh kerajaan Malaysia atas pre-communisian atau humanitarian ground dan juga disokong penuh oleh bangsa-bangsa bersatu.
I am not familiar with where and how they came in. The only thing that was a fact was that they ended up in Sabah.
Pada hari Merdeka, Malaysia Day, ada lebih kurang 100,000 orang. Orang dari Filipina, itu semua bangsa lah dari Filipina. Semua adalah bukan asli bangsa apa deh indigenous group dari Indonesia yang bekerja di Sabah pada masa itu merdeka. Dan pada masa itu barangkali orang Indonesia Filipin dekat-dekat 100,000. Orang Cina ada 10,000 lebih kurang. Orang India mungkin 100 orang. Ini orang semua diberi to start with, diberi kewarganegaraan by operation of law.
The MP for Tuaran, Datuk Wilfred Tanggau. In year 2006, he asked in Parliament why the Sabah population increased so dramatically in the past decades. And the answer by the Home Ministry is a written question and a written answer. And the answer by the Home Ministry is that it's not the population Sabah increased extraordinary. It's because of the people, a lot of people in the interior did not have birth certificate and they applied late their birth certificate. That's the reason.
Oleh kerana nampaknya meningkat orang Melayu, penduduk Melayu di Sabah, jadi diorang anggap ini semua IC. Tetapi diorang lupa, Malaysia ini sudah meningkat operation of law. Because dari 100,000 lebih, itu banyakannya orang Melayu Bugis masuk. China lebih kurang 10,000 saja dari Indonesia tu, ditawar banyak. And then India mungkin few hundred. Orang murut ada juga, jadi orang salah faham tu. Dari sempadan mungkin ada beribu-ribu juga. Jadi dia become citizen automatic.
And he gave a figure. By 2006, this Home Ministry punya parliamentary secretary said, by 2006, there were 740,000 late registration of birth. 740,000. That's why your population on papers as if it increased extraordinary. In fact, no, it's because the interior people did not have birth certificate. Interior people, 740,000, they had a birth certificate. But the question is, if the late registration of birth interior people, 740,000 by year 2006, why the statistic department say the Malay population in Sabah yang increased 2,000% in 40 years? And the KDM, who are the residents in the interior, total KDM increased by only 200% in 40 years. The Malay population 10 times.
I got the impression that the PBS was looked at by the federal government with a lot of suspicion. You know why? Because they look at PBS like a Christian-led government. You know, although PBS itself, I don't think it occurred to them. You know, it's just an elected government, that's it. But the fact is, I think KL is just not used to the idea that a non-Muslim government can lead a state government.
Well, Likas is a landmark case where the victory of the winning candidate was annulled and a by-election ordered. It was successfully proven that the electoral roll contains names of people who are not qualified to be there.
Saya petitioner, I proved to the court, accepted by the court, ada pengundi antuk phantom voters in Likas electoral roll.
You may remember that the High Court ordered former Chief Minister of Sabah, Datuk Yong Teck Lee, to vacate his Likas seat, state seat rather, because he won it in 1999 with the help of phantom voters who were not supposed to vote but allowed to vote.
So I find the judgment judicially sound, and it has been used in other cases in Malaysia, whereby the minute you have a roll where it contains people who are not qualified to cast their vote, then the election is set aside.
According to the judge, the evidence adduced was just the tip of the iceberg, according to the judge. Now, what surprises me, instead of cleaning the tainted electoral rolls, the Election Act was amended, whereby the electoral rolls, whether tainted or not tainted, once gazetted, cannot be challenged in any court of law. This is very surprising coming from a so-called responsible government. To me, personally, this is just not right, and it's bad law. You know, it's again the principle of democracy. Why would a government, responsible government, not interested to have a clean electoral rolls?
Okay. Pertama, seperti saya katakan tadi, tumbuhan penduduk Sabah adalah mula dari Malaysia Day by operation of law. Itu sudah tetap. Yang kedua, tidak ada projek IC. Even Dr. Mahathir was misquoted. Tidak ada projek IC. Tetapi, pada masa itu, politician, saya gunakan perkataan dia, mereka berabut-rabut mendaftar orang, sokong parti dia, masuk IC, sokong parti dia, supaya menambah dia punya wakil-wakil penduduk di kawasan-kawasan. Everybody doing that. Dari interior pun orang banyak, orang dari Kalimantan masuk, juga mendapat IC.
I cannot generalize. I can only speak from personal experience. The one that I met, few, came, I said, apa you punya aduan? Dia kata, aduan saya ialah, saya minta ini kad yang saya ada ditukar kepada kad yang betul-betul, bukan palsu pun ya. I said, what's wrong with your present card? Dia bilang, ini kad, kalau saya pergi airport, saya mau pergi Kuala Lumpur, tidak boleh. Saya kena tahan di sana. Saya mau yang my card, yang betul-betul my card. Ini apa ini, apa guna ini? Ini hanya ada guna kalau saya pergi mengundi, dia bilang. Saya bawa ini kad, pergi mengundi, nama saya ada di daftar. Saya undi, ini kad saya bawa ke pihak ketiga, dapat dua tiket, itu kad jasa rendah.
Some of them will choose the easy way out. Not many people know that the project ICs that were given to them only entitles them to vote in an election. After the election, they cannot even fly, they cannot even a bank account with it. So these are the problems that these migrants face as well. They came here to earn a living, and yet they were also cheated as well.
I never had or will have any intention of blaming the illegal immigrants for being in Sabah. As human beings, they are also looking for better life, better opportunities. They have equal human rights, no more, no less than any other human beings, including Malaysians. Their human rights must be respected. Human rights have no borders. However, the question many Malaysians in Sabah asked is, why are they or why they were allowed to enter the state illegally and move around within the state with impunity? It is alleged and perceived that hundreds of thousands of them have been granted citizenships as well as the right to vote.
Sindiket memang ada, pencurian memang ada. Macam sekarang kan, immigration, pegawai immigration berapa orang kena tangkap lah, berikut surat khabar. Nah, itu Pakistan mengakui yang dorang anu semua. Jadi ini ini perkara biasa di mana-mana negeri.
You remember, I don't know whether you remember that, 2002, I remember this vividly. 2002, 34 foreigners were arrested in Keringau because they were in possession of my card. 2002, my card had not even been introduced in Sabah. Subsequently, the my card were examined, whether they were genuine or not, and later on confirmed by the National Immigration Department and Immigration Department that they were genuine, produced and issued by Putrajaya. So, if that is not concrete evidence, I don't know what is, you know, that one.
I personally interviewed this NRD official who arrested by under the ISA, and they have confided to me information. And I've also gathered physical proof in terms of their photocopies of ICs in the hundreds, you know, as information chief of PBS at the time. And we have checked all these ICs against the electoral roll. And based on the information that all this evidence we have in PBS, we are convinced that there are many, many illegal immigrants or foreigners who were issued ICs fraudulently.
All of them said, this is to increase the Muslim voters in Sabah, without fail.
Muhammad Nasir bin Sumit, okay, he said he was directed by Haji Ramli Kamarudin, the then director of NRD Sabah, to replace the names of the temporary IC receipts and the lost IC receipts with those from the Election Commission in order to increase the Muslim voters in Sabah. They were arrested. But they were arrested under ISA. The question is, why ISA? Why not put them on trial? So we can find out, bring the evidence, so that the public knows what is happening. Actually, by arresting them under ISA, actually they were suppressing the evidence. They don't want the evidence to come out.
This Sabah RCI been requested at least since 1996 by the PDS party.
For example, in 1997, I think I spoke for about 45 minutes. I dedicated it to the PBS proposal for the formation of the Royal Commission of Inquiry.
But only recently, they agreed to set it up.
Just before the 13th general election, I think, then come this RCI. Finally, the federal government is going to be serious in resolving the issue. And after all, thousands and thousands of signatures have been requesting for the formation of RCI. So the federal government said, look, now here we are, we have the RCI. But I think had it not been for the impending general election, I don't think they would the RCI would come into being. I mean, this is just a speculation on my part. Whether people agree or not, that is my view.
One of the reasons that we finally returned to Barisan Nasional was that we believed but that good relations with the federal government would be able to help us address these issues. That was our firm belief. And I hope that the federal government does not disappoint Sabah.
So this RCI is on illegal immigrants in Sabah. Anything to do with immigrants, all mentioned in this RCI. The one thing people interested in this RCI is about the Project IC. Project IC been mentioned for years or so. But of course, government all those years denied.
Mana ada Project IC? Seperti saya katakan, masing-masing political parties, masing-masing individual, kalang kabut, berebut-rebut menambah ahli dia, parti dia, menambah pemundi dia, itu true. Nah, itu true. No such thing as a project di sini, project kita buat-buat, tidak ada.
Year 2000, they formed a federal cabinet committee on illegal immigrants in Sabah. Year 2000, Deputy Prime Minister is the chairman. Itu mesti Deputy Chairman is Abdullah Badawi, Tan Sri, Tun. 2006, when he himself became Prime Minister, he again said that he will form this same committee, not knowing that he was the chairman in the past 6 years. There's nothing done. That's 2006, he appointed Datuk Seri Najib as Deputy Prime Minister as the chairman. And 2008, after that election, he again announced the same name committee, Federal Cabinet Committee on Illegal Immigrants. 8 years, nothing had happened. When Datuk Seri Najib became Prime Minister, he realized it. And he formed a new committee. They call this committee Laboratory on Management of Illegal Immigrants in Sabah. Have you heard of that laboratory? A laboratory on management of illegal immigrants in Sabah. Chairman Tan Sri Muhyiddin. But in Sabah, there is a committee to gather facts. And they did it very fast in a few months. And they recommended 20 recommendations.
I've told you about the separation of powers between the state and the federal government. The only thing that PBS can do at the time actually was we collected the evidences. So we have the evidence, and we have provided all this evidence to the federal government. So we also know about a few names, and I think we've also reported them to the federal government. Now this begs the question, what did the federal government did on this information that PBS has provided to them?
Apa faedah kepada Sabah? I don't see anything keluar dari laporan daripada inquiry yang dibuat oleh Royal Commission Inquiry untuk Illegal di Sabah yang memberi faedah kepada Sabah. I don't see anything yang memberi faedah kepada Sabah. Waste of time.
Mungkin ada orang mengatakan bahwa ini tidak cukup. Ya, betul dia tidak cukup. Okay. Tetapi kalau kita bilang tidak berguna, itu salah. Karena di dalam buku ini terdapat banyak sekali bahan-bahan bukti yang telah dibongkarkan yang mungkin kita tidak dapat tanpa RCI. Dan juga saya mau bagi tahulah kepada kita semua bahwa bukti-bukti ini bukan saja kita boleh bawa dalam Mahkamah Negeri Sabah, tapi ini juga boleh diterima di peringkat antarabangsa. Karena melalui proses RCI ini adalah proses mahkamah.
You speak of RCI. RCI was the latest so-called action taken by the federal government to give the impression that they are doing something about it. But if you look at it in real life, this problem had been in the making for more than 40 years. Surely a government which cannot resolve an identifiable problem, and you cannot resolve it for more than 40 years, what else can you do better?
Saya ingin mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Perdana Menteri Datuk Seri Najib Razak kerana beliau telah berani untuk mengambil langkah untuk bersetuju dengan penemuan RCI ini. Dan memang kita berterima kasih. Kerana when credit is due, we must give the credit. Okay? Tanpa persetujuan daripada Ketua Menteri Sabah dan juga pada Perdana Menteri, tidak mungkin RCI ini wujud.
Datuk Najib ini orangnya baik. 100% baik.
Hanya persoalan saya sekarang, apabila saya membuka buku-buku ini, saya tidak nampak tanda tangan. Jadi persoalannya sekarang, kalau tidak ada tanda tangan, bagaimanakah buku ini menjadi satu buku yang sah?
RCI, laporan RCI itu mengatakan kerajaan tidak bersalah. Parti-parti politik tidak bersalah. Yang jari itu dituding kepada pegawai-pegawai kerajaan. Jadi bagi saya, yang betul-betul bersalah, dia dilepaskan. Yang mungkin hanya memberi sokongan, dipersalahkan. Yaitu pegawai-pegawai kerajaan. Sebagai pegawai-pegawai kerajaan, mereka saya yakin tidak berani untuk membuat keputusan dan mengambil tindakan seperti mana yang diambil oleh mereka tanpa restu dan persetujuan daripada political masters mereka ataupun dia punya tuan politik mereka. Kerana tugas dan tanggungjawab utama pegawai kerajaan ialah melaksanakan keputusan kerajaan, dasar kerajaan ataupun menterjemahkan dasar kerajaan kepada tindakan.
So the way forward is after the RCI, I do not find anyone being accountable for the fiasco. There are still denials. There are no concrete actions taken to make the people who are accountable to be prosecuted. And how do you deal with this large population of migrants who were given citizenships? Is there any way you can keep these people and yet reconcile with the local natives who are actually sidelined because of what the government did? So I feel that no one in the government or anyone in the opposition has been able to come up with concrete solutions to overcome this raging discontent among the people of Sabah.
Bagi saya, ini agenda kerajaan bagi Sabah. Jadi bagi saya tidak nampak macam mana ini boleh diselesaikan, sedangkan inilah rancangan kerajaan bagi untuk Sabah. Jadi dengan adanya pandangan seperti itu, saya susah saya memberi kepercayaan kepada diri saya sendiri bahawa RCI ataupun lain-lain boleh menyelesaikan masalah ini di Sabah.
Okay. This project I see also called Project Mahathir. Tun Mahathir silent on this thing until 2012. In this RCI, he said, Tun Mahathir said, I only knew about Project IC recently. I only knew about the book written by Mutalib entitled IC Project Agenda Tersembunyi Mahathir. I only knew about the book when I was called, when my statement taken to, before I come here to give evidence, they bilang. Tun Mahathir, Prime Minister for 22 years. During these 22 years, population of Sabah increased dramatically. The IC issued to foreigners, the Project IC, which he denied until recently, to hundreds of thousands of foreigners. 1995, 1996, 90 people arrested under ISA because of IC given to foreigners. He was Prime Minister. He was Home Minister. Home Minister. The Home Ministry passed the order to arrest 90 people, including 20 people NRDs punya staff, 30 people immigration punya staff. Under his Home Ministry punya kerja, department under his Home Ministry. Are you telling me he did not know about this? RCI ada cakap, all these things in pursuit of a political agenda. This is what is stated in the RCI. In pursuit of a political agenda. To me, this is federal punya political agenda. Political control over Sabah. Jom semua cakap increase Muslim voters, bukankah? At all cost. Itulah political agenda.